clothing and the anointing of the priests. And that's just the beginning. And now comes the offerings that they're required to offer. And beginning in Exodus 29, verse 10. Thou shalt cause a bullock to be brought before the tabernacle of the congregation, and Aaron and his sons shall put their hands upon the head of the bullock, and thou shalt, remember, a bullock is a small bull, and thou shalt kill the bullock before the Lord by the door of the tabernacle of the congregation, and thou shalt take of the blood of the bullock and put it upon the horns of the altar with thy finger, and pour all the blood beside the bottom of the altar, and thou shalt take all of the fat that covereth the inwards, and the fat that is above the liver and the two kidneys, and the fat that is upon them, and burn them upon the altar. But the flesh of the bullock and his skin and his dung shalt thou burn with fire outside the camp. It is a sin offering. Okay, and then keeping your place here, let's do the Leviticus 8 thing again. In Leviticus 8, we're going to start with verse 2 this time. And we're only going to read verse 2. Take Aaron and his sons with him, and the garments, and the anointing oil, and a bullock for the sin offering, and two rams, and a basket of unleavened bread. Now, if you'll skip down to verse 14. And he brought the bullock for the sin offering, and Aaron and his sons laid their hands upon the head of the bullock for the sin offering. And he slew it, and Moses took the blood and put it upon the horns of the altar round about with his finger, and purified the altar, and poured the blood at the bottom of the altar, and sanctified it to make reconciliation upon it. And he took all the fat that was upon the inwards, and the fat above the liver, and the two kidneys, and their fat, and Moses burned it upon the altar. But the bullock, and its hide, and its flesh, and its dung, he burned with fire outside the camp, as the Lord commanded Moses. All right, so this is, and I guess we can go back to Exodus 29 again. This is the first offering that is required for consecration as a priest. And so, really, it's, and if you think about it, this is an amazing thing, because they were becoming priests. They were already washed. They were already clothed. They were already anointed. And now they're bringing a sin offering? Does that seem strange to anybody? I mean, the order of that? Well, there's a reason behind it. And then, of course, notice in Exodus 29:10, they laid hands on it. And we'll talk about that, because each of the offerings that's going to be given, the first is a sin offering, the second is a burnt offering, and the third is a peace offering, they laid their hands on each one of those, all for different reasons. Okay, so... But here, all the priests do this together. They lay their hands on this, and they lay their sins upon it together. Because it's not just for their sins, but it is for their sins as priests. And I know that you don't believe that a man of God or a priest or whatever word you want to use needs help. But let's just say it like this. We all need Jesus. We all need Jesus. And I think it's a good reminder to priests, personally, that we all need Jesus. You know, there's a lot of judging can start happening when you think you're better than other people, and you don't, you know, everyone else messes up and you think you're so good or something like that. But this is a reminder of not just your own personal sin, but the sin of all the priests, and the sin as priests. And you know, it talks about that over in, you don't have to turn there, but I'll give you the verse if you want to write it down or look it up. Hebrews 7 speaks about this. Hebrews 7, 27 says, who needeth not, let's see, verse 26. For such an high priest was fitting for us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made better than the heavens, who needeth not daily, as those high priests, to offer up sacrifice, first for his own sins, and then for the people's. For this he did once when he offered up himself. And so there is this recognition of needing help, of needing forgiveness, of realizing and this is part of being a priest, is so that you can represent the people, folks. One of the points of being a priest is so that you know, being made of a human and being made of somebody that is flesh is so that you can understand the infirmities that they go through. Not just, you know, if you were more God than man, you would judge them. But he made priests out of men. And so, and again, this is not for a guilty sinner. This is for a guilty priest. And just this whole thing, I mean, if you consider, like on the Day of Atonement, you remember the Day of Atonement once a year where sacrifice was made for all the sins of Israel? Guess what? That atonement was for any of the priests, too, that had sinned. It was for all Israel. It wasn't just for the sinners or the sinning people of Israel. It was for all Israel because, in truth, all have sinned. And and as a sinner, you know, you'd have the Day of Atonement, but during the year, you might bring a sin offering, but you would do that personally. Do you know what I'm talking about? You'd bring your own personal sin offering just as an Israelite. But this, again, is different. This is different because this is relating to all of the priests. And so the main inward parts are burned. And the reason why I'm not getting into some of the things of that is that, you know, number one, I had a class on sacrifices and stuff. And I know I only got through burnt offering and never finished that, really. But in that class, if I ever come back to it, and I do have all my notes and what the Lord shared with me to share with you, so one day I might get a chance to finish that one. But in those classes, that's when you get into all of the specifics of everything. You don't do it here. You see what I'm saying? So we're just talking about the main inward parts were burned on the altar. On the altar. But the flesh, our flesh, the skin, our outward show, and the dung were all taken outside of the camp and burned. Interesting. Because what's taken outside of the camp is totally rejected. It's totally rejected. So, and the flesh and our old identification and all of the stuff we've done is taken to Calvary and taken outside the camp. And is destroyed. So, all right. And again, I'm going to have to try to finish all three of these within this time period if I'm going to, if I can. So, back to Exodus 29. Like I said, the first one was a sin offering, but now it starts getting into a burn offering. And then Exodus 29, beginning with verse 15, thou shalt also take one ram. Now, remember, the sin offering was a what? A bullock. And now we're taking a ram. Okay, thou shalt also take one ram, and Aaron and his son shall put their hands upon the head of the ram. See? Just like they did on the sin offering, they're putting the head on a burnt offering. But it has a different meaning. And thou shalt slay the ram, and thou shalt take his blood, and sprinkle it round about upon the altar, and thou shalt cut the ram in pieces, and wash the inward parts of him and his legs, and put them in pieces and unto his head. And thou shalt burn the whole ram upon the altar. It is a whole. It is a burnt offering unto the Lord. It is a sweet savor, an offering made by fire unto the Lord. And keeping your place there, Leviticus 8. And in Leviticus 8, looking at verse 18. And he brought the ram for the burnt offering. And Aaron and his sons laid their hands upon the head of the ram, and he killed it. And Moses sprinkled the blood upon the altar round about, and he cut the ram into pieces. And Moses burned the head and the pieces and the fat, and he washed the inwards and the legs in water, and Moses burned the whole ram upon the altar. It was a burnt sacrifice for a sweet savor and an offering made by fire unto the Lord, as the Lord had commanded Moses. So, and maybe you remember, maybe you don't, what all of those specific things represent, because we did get into that. But again, once the sin offering is done, then comes the burnt offering. And the burnt offering is a sweet savor unto the Lord. The sin offering is because you messed up. The burnt offering is something that the Lord wants from you now that sin is removed. Can I get amen on that? There's more to this than what most people give. And so the sin offering was a bullock, but the other one was a ram. And in verse 28 of Leviticus, or of Exodus 29, it says, "And he shall be Aaron's and his sons for statute forever." Let's see. Let me make sure that I'm reading in the right place here. Verse 18. "Thou shalt burn the whole ram upon the altar. It is a burnt offering unto the Lord. It is a sweet savor, an offering made by fire unto the Lord." And we saw that this offering represents Jesus in the sweet savor that he is in giving himself. It is a sweet lamb spirit to the Father. It is a sweet nature of self-giving unto the Father. It is not that he's giving him. And remember now, there's a bunch of different offerings. Right now we're just talking about three. Number one, sin. Number two, burnt offering. Number three, peace offering. But Jesus, in one sacrifice, in one offering on the cross, fulfilled all three of those and a whole bunch more, right? Jesus fulfilled all offerings in his death. So the only way you're going to see that is you're going to have to see each one of these. Sin offering. Most people see a sin offering. Very few see a burnt offering, and even fewer really see a peace offering. But Jesus gave himself for sin. For God so loved the world that he gave himself for our sin. But there was a whole nother side that pleased the Father that was a sweet savor to Jesus' death there. And that was he also gave himself as a burnt offering. What he did for the Father. He didn't do it for the cause. He didn't do it for the duty. He did it as the nature and by the nature, the self-giving nature that he has. Not because there was a need, sin. That sin offering was given for that. He gave himself because he is self-giving. And to the Father, that is sweet. It is a sweet savor offering unto the Lord. And so it was cut open and the inward parts were washed and the priest laid hands on this one also. And of course, when the priest laid hands on the sin offering, what was going on? Most of you know this. Why did they lay hands on the sin offering? To impart their sins on the substitute. It's like putting your sins on that substitute. So on the Day of Atonement, when the high priest laid his hands upon that sin offering, that offering for atonement, it was as if he put all of Israel's sin on that sin offering. That was his laying on of hands. But the burnt offering now we just read, they also laid hands on it. But you're not imparting your sin to a burnt offering because a burnt offering is not dealing with sin. What are you doing? You are identifying with God and agreeing with God that this is the kind of sacrifice he wants. Because when there's no sin, he still wants a self-giving nature that's called Christian. If you understand what I mean, it's actually Christ in you. And that's what he's after. And so this time you're laying hands on it and you're agreeing with the Father that this is more than just remedying our sins, that you want this nature in every one of us, and we lay hands on it and identify in the sense of identify with you in what it is that you desire. Okay? And then we'll see what the laying on of hands of the peace offering has to do later on. And basically you're laying hands on it and you're saying, this is the one that pleases God. This is the beloved Son. This is the one that, the only one that has the self-giving nature, And therefore, if we're not one with Christ, if he doesn't make us one, we're all rejected. But he does make us one. And ultimately, and we'll see this in the peace offering, ultimately, he wants this very sacrifice to become part of who we are. But right now, there has to be an acknowledging of the Lamb. You remember I've shared in John chapter 1, Gospel of John chapter 1, I think it's verse 29, where John the Baptist sees Jesus walking and he says, "Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world." Okay? Yes, sin offering. But then later on, John is standing there with his disciples. And it's not a sin issue, it's a disciple issue. And then he describes him and he says, "Behold the Lamb of God." Not the one that takes away the sin of the world. Because when we say, "Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world," all we think about is he doesn't have to be Lamb. It's just whoever it is, this guy is the one that's going to take away our sins. That's what we get caught up in the sin offering. That's what we see and that's what we want and everything. But John later on says it again, I think it's around verse 35, "Behold the Lamb of God." Take into consideration just the Lamb. What if there was no sin? What would Jesus be like? He would be self-giving, period. Doesn't require problems or sin or a situation or a need. And this is a lot of times when we don't have the Lamb formed in us, we try to be Lamb-like. Can I get amen on that? Because we do. Because we have, it's sort of like we believe in the Lamb, but he's not formed in us. When we see a need, that's when we want to be self-giving. Or when duty calls, that's when we want to be self-giving. But Jesus is self-giving. It's who he is. It is who he is. And he will always be that way. He was that way before the foundation of the world. He'll be that way after everything is said and done and gone. He will be self-giving. He will not be selfish. He will not be self-centered. He will put the Father first. He will put others first. That's why they're the first commandment. They said to Jesus, "What's the greatest commandment of all?" Well, you know, in the old covenant, it was like this. "Thou shalt," for example, using this commandment, "thou shalt not steal," pointing the finger saying, "thou shalt not steal." But in the new covenant, it is said like this. "Thou shalt not steal." It's not your nature. It's Christ in you isn't wanting to do that. That's not how he is. "Thou shalt not, you know, murder. Thou shalt not do this." You see what I mean? Because it's not a command, trying to command a nature that runs cross-grain to Christ. It's not trying to command that nature to shape up, because you'll never shape up a nature by commanding it. In fact, a lot of times you unleash it by commanding it, you know. So the commandments and the law was never the answer. Christ in you is the answer. And so in the new covenant is you have life. You don't just have life, you have Christ. And Christ is this way. He's a self-giving nature. So guess what? Thou shalt not. You know, it's just a fact more than it is a command. Okay. So, again, anybody see the need for conforming to the image of Christ? And not just us, but what if we could bring all Christians into that? You know? All right, so then just trying to close out on this note of becoming Lamb-like instead of it being the Lamb. It comes out of sincerity. It comes out of a desire to please the Father. It comes out of pride to look good in front of others. It comes out of, I mean, I'd like to say it all came out of a beautiful heart, but it doesn't, you know. I don't know if anybody ever see that movie, A Beautiful Mind? I got news for you. That man's mind was creepy crawly. Okay? I don't know where they got A Beautiful Mind from, but he didn't have. But that's us. We think we have a beautiful mind, and it is crawling with all sorts of slivery, slimy things, man. My God. you know. And so, you know, and we've got all these hidden motives, and a lot of times, do you know, the scriptures say more about not deceiving yourself than it says about the devil deceiving you. If you've never searched it out, you'll be shocked. You'll go, oh my God, you know, because you spent, you know, in your early Christianity, you go, I don't want the devil to deceive me. You know what I mean? You're like on guard, you know, and all this kind of stuff. And so he's sitting there kind of hacked off. The devil sort of hacked off because you're holding him at arm's length while you're busy deceiving yourself and not allowing him to do his job, you know. But we do that. We deceive ourselves. And why do we do that? We do it to justify so we can feel better about ourselves. Folks, if we can somehow break with this thing of feeling better about ourselves and making our one goal to have Christ's life to please the Father by the Son, then it just breaks down so many things. And that way you don't have to deceive yourself. And then when you do things, you will, you know, the example I always use is, anybody work on a computer and maybe get on the internet and stuff like that, and you know that there's all sorts of stuff on the internet that'll try to, you know, the viruses and all this stuff that'll spyware and all this that'll try to put on your computer, you know what I mean, and all this kind of stuff. But there's a program called Norton, and you put Norton on your computer and it blocks, you know, viruses and it blocks spyware and it blocks all this kind of stuff, and you can still go out and, you know, da 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 da, but you know, for the most part it'll block it, and if something gets through you can just start it and it'll find it and hunt it down and kill it. Well, my Norton that I believe we should have is a Norton that discerns our motives, our virus called our motives. We have a virus within ourselves that is bad motives. And we think that we have good motives. But really we're doing something, and so what this Norton does is while you're doing something, thinking you're doing it out of good motive, it goes, ah. Now think about it. I want you to ask yourself right now, why are you really doing this? And sometimes there's dual motives. Amen? Is it possible to have a motive coming from your spirit and one coming from your soul? It is. And so, but you're only, it's like the one that's coming from your spirit, you know, it's only that big, and the one coming from your soul is this big. But you shove it, the one from your spirit, up front, and you shove the other one behind your back, it's still on you like that monkey, winged monkey. You know, looking over your head going, yeah, look at that motive right there. And you go, oh, yeah, it's the Lord, you know. How much is it the Lord? Well, I see it. It's the Lord. I'm telling you, Randy. It's the Lord working in me. You know, and this monkey's back there going, you know. We're, you know, whispering in your ear, we're in this together. You know. And so what the Norton is really, it is a combination of your openness and the Holy Spirit that says, wait a minute, what's really going on here? And when you've made a pattern in your own life of deceiving yourself, it's hard to get past, it's hard to find what's in the background, you know. But the Holy Spirit and your heart for the Lord will start bringing it out. And I'm going to tell you something. It's very disheartening. It's very discouraging to find out how much spyware and virus we've got on our computer. You know, we run Norton and goes, you have 2,587. You go, oh, my God, I was wondering why everything was crawling like, you know, oh. So slow, you know, big glut, you know. you type in one word and it takes 5 minutes to register. Dog, you know. You go, oh, this is slow. And it's all this stuff that's just bogging us down. And, again, a lot of it is there, but it's hidden. And we haven't brought it to the surface, and that's what the Norton is supposed to do, is bring it all to the top and start getting But it starts small, and it starts in a situation where you go, you know, Lord, I just want to say I want to, and he shows you something, and then you go, oh gosh, man, you know, and it, you know, if he brings up five or six things, it's very discouraging. And the battle that you always fight, and the one that I'm always warning you against, is condemnation. You are in Christ, and there is no condemnation. But we keep falling into condemnation, and it's wrong, and you're acting like you're a Jew. You're acting like you're under the first covenant instead of in Christ. In Christ, it's settled. It's already done. The fact that you're not walking in it doesn't change the fact that it's settled. He says, as for me, my covenant is with you. But I'm a mess right now. Yeah, but what you really are is what you are in my Son. That's what the Father would say to you. Now wake up and quit looking. So he's shaking you continually, trying to shake you out of a mentality of condemnation and getting down on yourself. And trust me, if you get down on yourself, you're probably getting down on others. And probably some of the only relief you get is to get down on others. Because this thing, you know, it'll work. It wants to get down on something. So we feel better about it getting down on somebody else. But folks, the more you let it get down on somebody else, you're allowing it to grow. You're giving it, you're feeding that baby and accepting it, and it will turn around and attack you eventually. And I know that's not what you're wanting, but and so that's why you let it attack others through you. But you're still letting it stay alive in you. And you need to, if you want to condemn something, condemn that. But that's not you. That's probably the enemy. It could be anything from demonic to just, you know, self-protection and pride. But the point is, you got to start bringing this stuff out. And as you do, don't go into condemnation. Go into a situation of, I believe in the Lord, and I'm determined to get all of this stuff out and let it be Christ, and I'm not there yet, and it may take me a long time, and I've seen enough to scare me to think I'll never get there, but my heart is with the Lord, and I'm going on, and I believe in you, Jesus. And you have, that's the stand you have to take. I'm telling you, you cannot stay in condemnation. Why? Because it paralyzes you, and it makes you not want to do anything. You know, and one of the biggest things you can do to break that is just get up and do something for God from a right motive. You know, just go, I'm going to go serve God in some manner. I'm going to go bless. I'm just going to go help somebody. I'm going to call somebody up and ask them if they need their dishes done. Or, you know, I'm just trying to, you know, anything that will really, you say, this is Jesus. This is my desire to be with Jesus. You know, and you just go for it. I see hands going up for you can come do their dishes. My God. Now, what motive raised your hand? Yeah. Now, there's a perfect example of that monkey in the background working. No, not really. Not really. However, you know, other people can't tell you about these monkeys, about these wrong motives. Did you hear what I just said? I would say at least up to easily 75% of the time, other people cannot tell you that. Because if they do, the very pride that's hiding those motives will get mad at them. It talks more about deceiving yourself. And so, you know, the answer to not deceiving yourself is to not deceive yourself. it's incredibly deep, I know. However, a light just went off for some of you. Yeah, because you're trying to get somebody else to help you not deceive yourself, but you're deceiving yourself, you know what I mean? It's just, oh Lord, you know, I mean, the scriptures tell you don't deceive yourself. Why would he do that if God was just going to undeceive you? You stand for God. You make a stand. You say, I'm sick of my sleazy motivations, and I'm ready to go with the Lord, and I'm ready to get it all out. And it does take a while, and it's a little bit of a mountain to climb, but I tell you what, on the other side of it, it is so much easier. I mean, again, your computer starts running faster and everything, and you can do a lot more, and stuff's going on. Oh, I can run two programs at once. I'm getting more done. You know what I mean? It's really like that. It's like, you know, everything starts kicking in, and life gets a little easier, but it's hard at first when you have to deal with this. But the motivation has to be, I want the Lord, and I want the Lord in me, and I want it to be real. And I'm going to tell you, I'm going to tell you one reason. I'm just going to go ahead and say this here. I'm going to tell you one reason, one difference between me and say, people like JW or other people that teach. One main difference. And one reason why a lot of people, even though he's harsher than me, people don't like me more than him. And that is, much of the time when I teach, I'm dealing with motives. And that's a tough one. It's much easier to sit and just hear about being in Christ. And let me tell you, you need that too. And that's why I'm glad we got him and others that teach that. But it's much easier just to hear about the things that happened in Christ and about what happened at the cross and it's settled and what, you know what I mean, that doesn't deal with your day-to-day walk and attitudes and, you know, criticalness and all that. It doesn't deal with any of that. It just says, hey, this is the way it is. It's easy and it's wonderful. And there's nothing to get mad about. I'm in Christ. I'm dead, and it has no more meaning other than theologically that something happened, and praise God, I'm dead. I can do anything I want. You know, and that's not necessarily the but some people do come to that conclusion. Jim and I were talking about that. I mean, some people do. People, you know, it's almost like meddling when you deal with motives. I mean, that's the way people feel. So, what are you talking about me for? You know, I mean, I wish I could think of the most recent incident, and there was one very recent here. And, you know, I mean, I'm just doing my best to share Jesus, and that's the truth. I mean, I really am. I'm not trying to meddle or anything, but this is the avenue that the Lord has launched me in to teach. So I deal with it. And I can't remember the exact situation. All I remember is that what should have been a blessing, someone just, you know, took it like, well, you know, you're getting into stuff you shouldn't be getting into and whatever, and just, you know, share the Lord, meaning something up there. And I'm thinking, you know, I wasn't talking to you. Maybe the Lord was. Apparently, the Lord was. But could you do me a favor and go work this out with him? You know? I mean, it's like a messenger coming to the door and going, well, you know, your father died. As if the messenger murdered him or something, you know? I didn't do it. I didn't even know him. You know? You've heard it. Don't kill the messenger. But nonetheless, see, I don't have any choice because this is the area that God has called me to deal with. And I know that there's a balance. I know that. And I don't guess there's anybody here out of all of our preachers that gets right in there, I mean, like a surgeon and digs where I shouldn't, you know, or where I should, like I do. But we have other people that also bring in other aspects and more soothing and, you know, whatever. And so there's more of a balance, and I thank God for that. And we bring in people like JW and many other people, and I thank God for that. There has to be a balance. I don't know why I got off on this, but for some reason I have to share all this, so I'm going to. I remember one time that me and Don Anderson went to New York City. And one of the reasons we went there was that we were going to check out David Wilkerson's church. And this has been years and years and years ago, okay? And and so while we were there, we came on a Sunday morning. And David Wilkerson preached. And I was so glad because David Wilkerson, you know, I mean, he preached every Sunday morning. And he got up there because he's a prophet. And he blasted everybody. I mean, he blasted them every Sunday and every Sunday night and every Wednesday. And so afterwards, I couldn't meet. At that time, we did finally meet with David Wilkerson, but we couldn't meet with him immediately. So we met with the guy who was considered the pastor of the thing. We sat down and talked. And I said, how do you handle a prophet preaching every time? I mean, doesn't that sort of, you know, because I mean, after the service, everybody was just like, oh, you know, it's like bodies and blood. Or, oh. You know, I mean, you think I'm bad, honestly, that guy, you know. And he said, well, the truth is we don't, and we're about to change all that, and I will be teaching on Sunday mornings, and he's going to take Sunday nights, and then I'll take Wednesdays, so that a pastor is ministering the word and stuff like that. I saw the balance for that. And there have been many times when I have considered myself David Wilkerson in the sense that I'm a lot more sharp, and I get to the point and stuff like that, and I think you can't take too much of me. I mean, you know, I mean, it's sadly the truth. You just, you know, and I have a pastor's heart also in me. I really do. But I realize that the way the Lord is in me and the way the Holy Spirit opens the word to me, it's almost as if I have fought to not go in these directions, and it doesn't matter what I do. I have read some of the most carnal books to get my, so I could come up with a sermon outside of, I'm honest, it's the truth, to get outside, and they would make a fatal mistake in their book. They would quote a scripture, and in that scripture, I would see this again, and go, oh my God, you know, and it's just like, and this happened so much that I said, you know, I'm fighting something that's God. I'm fighting against God here. I have to share what God's called me to share. But we need Jim and Scott and others, and we need more of a balance. We need that whole thing. But now, having said all of that, folks, we also need me, and we need people like me to deal with motives, because motives are how we live our life daily. No, how we live our life moment by moment. And if we don't get this stuff right, we're not really being consecrated as a priest. We may have done a little bit of washing, you know, because we got in the word, but we weren't washed. And we might have a little bit of anointing when it comes to being set apart and all that kind of stuff. And we might have changed some of our clothes a little bit, you know, put on a little collar or something, you know, and, you know, look more priestly or whatever. And we may have acknowledged the sin offering. But when these priests laid their hands on the burnt offering, and when they lay their hands on this peace offering, there is a level of consecration that jumps vastly out of the realm of fallen man and into the realm of eternal God. I mean it. I mean, it steps out of all of our frailties and all of our failures, and it gets us right into the heart of what God had planned for us from the very beginning. And it moves us from carnal viewpoints that always are under condemnation and always feel bad about how good they're doing or how bad they're doing and everything. And it moves you into how good He is and how wonderful He is, and that you're one with Him, but you don't even worry about it because you're not sin conscious, you're Christ conscious. You're not sin centered, you are Christ centered. And it moves you out of all of the stuff about you and moves you into all of the stuff about Him. It's like leaving one room and coming into another, leaving your room, which is junky and got junk everywhere and rats and roaches and all your stuff and all my stuff and, you know, food laying there and all this stuff, and you walk through it and, you know, dirty clothes and it stinks and smells, and then walking into His room that is full of life and new, you know, like spring breaking forth, new life coming, budding and beauty and everything else, and you're just going, man, I just think I want to live here. And that won't mean anything if somebody says that until you experience that. All the talking and all the preaching in the world will not convince you. The best it might do is, if there is such a reality, I'd like to know it. And then you open your heart to the Lord to find it out. But that's all. I mean, that's what it's about. That's where we're going. We're leaving the outer court, and we're coming into the holy place, and when we get out of there with the burnt offering, we're going into the peace offering in the Holy of Holies. We're changing rooms. We're moving up. We're, you know, Remember that Jefferson's moving on up, you know? Yeah, well, that's you know, that's great, except for we're not going to the east side. We're going into the Holy of Holies where the presence of God dwells. Amen. Praise God. So anyway, this whole thing of just recognizing with the burnt offering, whatever happened to him happens to us, not just in death, not just over sin, but whatever, we're so joined to him, we're so one with him, that whatever happens with him happens with us. I mean, oneness is a marvelous, marvelous thing. And I'm going to tell you something, I need to close with this, and I know I'm sort of excited over this, but I think it's a wonderful thing. I admit, and you know, we don't have a lot of relating, and I think, you know, I'm just going to say this too. I think that out of all of my faults, and I've got plenty, but one of my biggest faults is I just don't spend enough time relating. I mean, me and Jim hardly ever talk. Me and Scott hardly ever talk. Me and, you know, Jason and Ben don't talk like we should. My own kids I don't talk with, you know. My wife I do because we're in the car together. You know, and I think the Lord's working on me on some of that. But the truth is, thank God for oneness. Now there is, and it's not an excuse, but there is a wonderful reality in oneness that produces things that communication doesn't. It's a more clear channel. It's a more smooth channel. I mean, the most recent event I can think of that is just as I was leaving to come in here, I bumped into Patty. And there's a little project that I've had on my heart, and I feel like I need to find out more information about it and get down the road with it. And about 6 months ago, I guess, there was a beginning stage of that. And it was going to need the help of Patty. And I came to Patty, and she said, well, praise God, you won't believe this, but like 2 days ago or whatever, the Lord already started me doing that, and I'm already on the road to that. Well, when I walked, that was about 6 months ago. When I walked out and just bumped into her, and Deb's up here doing announcements, and I know I'm going to have to run up here, I have to throw this stuff out to Patty real quick. It's like, oh, here's what I'm looking, and here's, and da-da-da-da. You know, you talk about communication. Oh, thanks for the two-minute download. You know, blah, 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 you know. And she says, well, you're not going to believe this, but about 2 days ago, the Lord was dealing with me, and I'm already working on it. And I went, yes, yes, yes. You know? And, that's just a small example, but I'm so thankful for oneness because, folks, we are one with the Lord. Amen? Guess what? We're one with one another, too. We're not just members of his body. We're members of one another. We are, and there is a flow. And again, I don't mean it to be an excuse or whatever, but it can't be ignored or denied. There is a wonderful flow that happens by life when we not just plug into the Lord, but through that our channels are open through the body of Christ. The life that is the Lord comes into his body, which is members, and flows from member to member and through extremity to extremity all throughout. I mean, I don't think there's going to be, you know, I'm going to say it like this. I don't think there's going to be any intercoms in heaven. You know, I know that's both the intercom and the heaven side, the way most people picture it sort of done. But I mean, I can just see it. Well, I'm in my mansion and you're in yours. And hey, how's it going over there? I don't think there's going to be any of that, folks. I believe there's going to be. You know, that river, it's going to be a pure river and a pure flow flowing all the way through us. You talk about the river of life. Oh, you know, cut your right there. You'll see the river of life. And it's flowing. And it's flowing throughout the whole body. And the life is in the blood. And the life is Christ. And he's flowing in us. And he's meant to produce. And if nothing else, we're meant to be an example. And a not more than an example, but certainly an example of that. But an example and a spiritual release of that savor into this earth. You say, but we're so small, we're insignificant. My God, if we're doing that, that's greater than 5,000 members in a church that's, you know, just learning to hop on one foot during worship or something. I don't know. But I'm just trying to, you know, give you an example. that I mean, the flow of the, if we're capturing the essence of what's Christ, the essence of what is Christ, and then releasing that, we won't know the toll of that. That sounds negative, but it's positive. We won't know the toll of that until eternity. You know, we'll have no clue. But it depends on what's important. And to me, this whole thing about consecration of priests, what is a New Testament priest? Melchizedek, the high priest, and being the body of the high priest. This is what's important to God, because look how much of the scriptures is full of it. You know? I mean, it's an incredible amount is full of these realities. And so, you know, it's like this. Open up the channels. Open your channel to God. Open your channel to one another. And I don't mean, you know, I mean, get hold of the Lord in a certain way. It's like this. Well, we don't do as many outreaches or stuff as we used to, so I don't really have a channel of ministry. My God, there is no end to the channel of ministry to someone full of Jesus. The life of Christ will make things. It just can't, you know, you can't stop life. You cannot stop life. You know how I know that? Because at a certain juncture in my ministry, it was like someone was trying to shut me down, a particular person, so that there would, you know, I wouldn't really have much of a ministry. And I was so cut off from preaching and cut off from doing this and cut off from doing that and cut off doing that. And I remember my little girls, remember my little office in the front of the mobile home there? And I'd sit in there and write books. It was the only outlet I had. And I never thought, I mean, me a writer, come on. My God, I made C's, D's, and mostly F's in English. I'm not lying to you. And I've written probably over 100 books by now, you know. But it was the Lord, it was life. And, you know, even if they were bad grammar and everything else, and they were, I mean, thank God for Mallory, but, you know, I mean, thank God for Mallory. But thank God for Jesus, because he was just like, I've got to come out somewhere. You know, I'm telling you, nobody has to open a door or put a pulpit in front of you for life. If you got life, it's going to find a way. Poor thing, me, I'm beating on the thing. I wonder what that sounds like. Anyway, I just, you know, if nothing else, I just want to give glory to God for the life of his son, the life of his son, the present life of his son, the realness of Jesus. And, you know, the Philistines go around trying to plug up the wells. You remember that? And Abraham, you know, Abraham would dig them. The father would dig them, the Philistines would plug them up, and the son, Isaac, would come back and unplug them. Maybe we just need to end tonight with a prayer to unplug, that the son would start unplugging the channels. Is that okay with everybody? Why don't we just, to show a little something behind it, an act of faith, let's just stand to our feet, not because you're asked to by the head honcho, but because we're going to do it as an act of faith. And saying, we're standing with you, Lord. We're standing with you. Father, you just gave me that. You just quickened me with that example, Father, that you dug the wells. You made the way. It was in your heart. It was in your heart, and you dug all the wells, and you opened up all the channels, and there were wells all over the place. And then the Philistines came in, even after you had worked and accomplished all of this and done it freely. And they started plugging them up. And then the son, Isaac, came and he started unplugging the wells. Father, we just want to ask the Holy Spirit, and we want to ask the Son of God to begin to move in each life, each member of the body through whom the flow comes to whom the flow comes and through whom it flows to others, to be unplugged right now in the name of Jesus. Son, Jesus Christ, unplug these wells right now. Unplug these and let a flow begin to come. A new, yes, 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 a new, fresh, alive flow. Fresh, clean flow of water. that brings refreshing to the one to whom it comes and through whom it comes to a lot of other people. Refreshing. Father, I just ask you to break down the walls of all of the boundaries that they think are holding them back and to give them creative ways of bringing forth more of the Son of God in this earth. Releasing the Son, because their hearts are open to you and they want you. And they want a release of you greater than what they've got. Even if it's wonderful, they want more. And so, Father, release the wells, release the flow, flowing all throughout the body of Christ, refreshing and filling up and satisfying all those who come and drink. Oh, Father, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. And I say it again because I feel prompted of you to pray it again, fresh, creative ideas and ways of releasing the life of Christ. Yes. Well, I sense the Spirit of God moving on that. I really do. I do. I sense the Holy Spirit. Oh, hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. Yes. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Well, the Lord just told me that it's not over with, and that at during the Passion at Dove Ranch, that instead of me preaching or something, we'll get together, sing a few songs, be led of the Lord in that manner, and then we'll just pray together, and we'll pray for one another, and some specific things will come to you, and you be praying right now for yourself, but pray for others too that are there, that they get some specific downloads from the Father. And I'm asking you to be open channel, because we prayed it right now. So let there be a creative flow through you to different members of the body of Christ. From this moment after we say amen, if the Holy Spirit starts bringing to remembrance somebody, or you start thinking about them and you just think it's you thinking about them and a couple of thoughts come, consider that may be the Lord giving you something that you may pray over someone, that you may help them, that you may cover them, that you may bless them, that you may stand with them. If nothing else, letting them know that you stand with them and that you have faith, and that they may be going through a trial, but you have faith for them. Hallelujah. And let our time together flow out of what's happening in our time together right now. Yes, and I just feel led of the Lord to say to you that there are certain people who have made themselves available to the flow and the channel of the Lord. This is almost a word from the Lord. Thus saith the Lord, there are those who have made themselves available as a flow and a channel of my Spirit and of my life, saith the Lord, at the Passion and at other things that you attend. And there are certain people that seem to always lead, but they're not leaders. They're not being leaders. They're not called upon as leaders. They are not set in an office or a position. They are simply have made themselves year after year a channel, and my life, saith the Lord, flows through them, and my creative ideas come to them, and they move with that, and they impart that. But I say to you, any one of you can and should be available. Do not assume that they are meant to be the leaders and no one else. Nor, saith the Lord, gripe about them as though they're always the ones and you never are. For they simply heard from me, saith the Lord, and I flowed through them because they were the available channels. Make yourself available, saith the Lord, and I will flow through you. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, hallelujah. Wash in the presence of the Lord right now. Wash in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. The washing of the water is falling on that dirt that has plugged up your hole, and it's fixing to fall into that. It's fixing to fall into that well, and life, living waters, is going to come out of you. Hallelujah. You are called to it. You are consecrated to it. You are my priest, saith the Lord. This is not a special gift. This is what you are called to. And I will do it, saith the Lord. And I have prepared your garments, saith the Lord. And I have made the way, saith the Lord. And I will provide all the sacrifice through the Son that you would ever need, for he has finished each and every step of the way. And you will simply awaken and put on and wash with and embrace what is there. Hallelujah. For you need not work. You need but look and believe and behold. And I say, some of you that are coming to the Passion are new, are fairly new coming to it. But I am going to use you. I'm going to use you. And I'm going to do it to confront some who would never suspect that you are my tool. But I'm going to use you as my tool. And they are going to see this tool in my hand, saith the Lord. And they will find a new respect for you. Because they will see my Son, and they love my Son, and when they see him in you, they will love you and respect you, saith the Lord. Be open and available, saith the Lord. Do not fear what man will think. I say unto you, step out on the water and watch me keep you up. Hallelujah. Some of you say, yes, Lord, right now in your spirit. Praise God. It is his intention. I heard it. It's his intention. I'm looking for it. I'm joyous over it. Doesn't disturb me. It makes me happy. Hallelujah. I'm excited to see more of Jesus in his body, in more members of his body. I'm excited to see that. I want to see that. That is his desire, and it's my desire. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I just see if we're doing horseshoes or volleyball or any games or something like that, and the Lord puts it on your heart to just pray for somebody or to be there for them or to go walk with someone that's down and out or whatever, you do that and you be faithful and you do it faithfully as unto the Lord, not fearing what man shall think, because you are chosen of him and called of him to minister and to wash the body of Christ. And you will do it because I know your heart, saith the Lord. You will do it. I know you, saith the Lord. I know you. Oh, hallelujah. The Lord just quickened that picture of Nathanael under the tree. And he was sitting there and Andrew brought him up and introduced him. And Jesus said, I saw what you were doing under the tree. And he was shocked that, you know, he thought Jesus didn't see. And he wasn't doing anything wrong. It was something good and something that was in his heart and dear that the Lord was blessed with. And the Lord is saying that some of you have been Nathanael in the background. You didn't think the Lord was watching, but he is watching. He knows your heart. He knows how you've been with him in a lot of ways that people are not aware of, but you are aware of, Lord. And that he's going to do like he did with Nathanael. He's going to take you from ministering under trees in silence and in quiet and in hidden places. He's going to bring you as one of the 12 to bring forth the life of Christ to the body of Christ. Hallelujah. 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 Jennifer, you can sit. I didn't mean you had to stand. If anybody else feels like you've been standing for a long time, imagine standing up here for 2 hours. You may be seated or go or leave. No, I guess we have, somebody needs to hunt down Deb. I think we have a meeting, and I'm sorry we went over with this prayer, but I'm not sorry. But we do have a few things we need to cover on this here meeting, and I'm not sure without the head honcho. If anybody needs to go to the restroom, this would be a good time.